Hello, Sumners, it's Christoph here. It's been a minute since the last time we've done one of these, but welcome to another one of our pro player analysis videos. A highly anticipated one, too. TF Blade hit rank 1 on 2 servers this season, so we're going to go over how an NA talent has gone on to conquer both the NA and EU West servers. We're always reading your comments and trying to improve our videos for you guys, so let us know if you have any feedback, suggestions, or just want to let us know that we're doing a good job. There's a lot to cover, so let's get started. In this game, TF Blade is playing Irelia, Big Shock, versus Odoamne on Jax. As always, let's talk about the matchup. This is one of the most timeless matchups in League. Even before Irelia's rework, we would see players attempt to win lane and 1v9 the game from either side. With how snowbally this lane is, both of these champions have the same goal: win lane and then make their opponent useless by either gaining leads, split pushing and diving their opponent over and over, or pushing lanes in, roaming and carrying team fights. Jax will want to constantly look for long fights where he can auto attack freely and use Counter-Strike to win. Irelia wants to look for fights where there are a lot of minions on both sides. She wants her own minions to deal damage and needs enemy minions to jump around and avoid Jax's stun. While this lane does favor Jax, it's typically viewed as a skill matchup, and TF Blade shows us why. TF Blade has built a reputation as NA's best Irelia player, sorry Jibe, so it's certain that he has strong knowledge of this matchup and knows how to win it. His understanding of matchups is the first step in his ability to carry games. He understands things like using small range advantage, setting up his wave for outplays, and most importantly, whether he wins or loses based off items and levels. With this knowledge, he knows how and when he can get leads to snowball with. The first thing to note is that TF Blade leashes for his jungler. This means that his jungle pressure will be headed bot side, and it's likely that the enemy jungler will be headed up to him, since Jax didn't leash. Recognizing that he won't have jungle pressure, he tries to maximize his time where he can farm safely, pulling the wave that Jax pushes in, so that the lane spends more time close to his turret. From here on out, he plays with the natural flow of the wave. When you crash a wave into turret, it usually starts a pattern where the wave will naturally bounce back and forth between each side. This is because the next enemy minion wave will be caught at their turret. Stay there until your minions are cleared, then meet with your next wave closer to their side. This concept of wave dynamics is a little bit hard to understand, and if you guys are having trouble implementing these into your games, then please click the description link below and watch some tutorials on wave management on ProGuides.com. When waves are even and closer to one side, they will push to the other, and the pattern will repeat itself over and over unless someone heavily impacts the minion wave. While this playstyle is pretty boring, this is an essential part of how TF Blade 1v9s his games. After catching the wave under his turret, TF Blade's wave is naturally going to slowly push into Jax's turret. From here, we need to bring up what TF Blade does to carry his games. He exercises calculated aggression. Calculated aggression is playing aggressively only when you know it's safe to, because you're able to see or infer the position of your enemies. This approach to the game is superior because you don't rely on unreliable all-ins that you can be punished for. Over the course of several games, if you just played with blind aggression, you would sometimes get a kill and sometimes just die to the jungler. By playing with calculated aggression, every time you look for an all-in, it should lead to a kill, or at least give you something to learn from, because the reason you lost the fight wasn't, "I'm getting camped by the jungler." Knowing this, let's look at what he does next. He gives up 5 of the 6 minions in the next wave. This is because Rek'Sai is topside. If he looks to farm here, there's a high chance he will get ganked and die. Instead, he sits back and lets the wave push in by itself, only jumping on the last minion because his next wave has arrived. Although it's likely that Rek'Sai is still topside, there's an equally likely chance that he can outplay his opponent with a wave this big. He proceeds to push the wave completely into Jax's turret and goes toward the window he's created. Again, once the wave is clear, he gives up CS and sits back because he still doesn't know where Rek'Sai is. Tracking the jungler is absolutely essential in all top lane matchups. If you guys are interested in understanding more concepts about tracking junglers and even getting better at the jungle role yourself, then please check out ProGuides.com, where you'll see serious improvements to your guys' rank. At 5 minutes, TF Blade was initially letting the wave push into him, but finally plays aggressively. Previously, his jungle pressure was bot side, so the best decision was just to farm and avoid fighting, but now he has teammates nearby this time. With his teammates here, he's not afraid to bait Jax into a fight, and together, they'll kill Jax and push in the wave for a reset. Rek'Sai gets greedy and they manage to pick up a free kill on her, allowing TF Blade to finally base as they've nearly pushed in the wave. Shortly after, TF Blade lets Jax slow push again. Without vision of the enemy jungler, it's the smartest play to just play with the natural flow of the wave. Even though he's ahead, he allows Jax to push because if he gets ganked here, the matchup will swing back in Jax's favor and TF Blade will lose his lead. A little later, Rek'Sai is spotted bottom, matching Sejuani's gank. Even at full health, TF Blade uses his Corrupting Potion because he knows he wants to fight Jax. He does this so he can get his mana back, and he can immediately have the damage boost ready for his first instance of damage. At 6 minutes and 40 seconds, the two have their first brawl. Jax will naturally win these fights at melee range, barring any extraordinary circumstances. TF Blade is aware of this, so he immediately jumps to the minion wave to get away from Jax to create that distance that he needs. He lands a stun and then begins to auto-attack, and then uses his W to set up the wave. This is paramount in this matchup because, like we mentioned before, Irelia loses fights head-on. She needs to dodge Jax's stun and also heal off minions with her Q to win. TF Blade is successful and ends up winning the 1v1. You can argue that TF Blade only lost here because Oduwamne autoed a minion, but TF Blade also made a mistake by wasting his Q and an auto attack, while Oduwamne was using Counter-Strike, making it a fair fight. What he does after this is important as well. He knows that Zed is off the map, so he backs off and prepares to potentially recall. Once Zed shows up again on the map, and also knowing that Rek'Sai was too far to be there, he pushes it out. In snowbally matchups like this, item leads are the most important thing, so you want to base with as much gold as possible every time. While he could recall and let the wave bounce back to him, if he clears this wave instead, he'll have more gold to spend. At this point, Jax can only fight Irelia if he can catch up in items. To do so, he needs to recall again, which would cost time, wave tempo, and minions to do so. However, a little bit later at 8 minutes and 20 seconds, TF Blade tries to snowball his lead by baiting Jax's E, but ends up getting punished by a dive. He made a risky play here since the wave was already crashing into him. He could have avoided trading and looked to farm the wave instead. Following this, he actually calls for a lane swap, and he does so for three reasons. First, it gets him out of the matchup. Since Jax has equalized it, he can win fights now. And by level 9, if both champions are even, Jax will easily win these fights. And TF Blade knows this. They'll both have more health, so even if Irelia kites him and jumps around like before, she'll eventually run out of minions and lose to Jax. Secondly is lane priority. He recognizes that Ryze is losing to Zed, which is a factor in why TF Blade was able to get Dove and Jax could get back into the game. By continuing to go top, the same thing will happen over and over again, so he wants to go mid to fight for lane priority. If you guys are having trouble understanding lane priority, we have a great course on what it's all about and how to utilize it. Click the description link below. The third reason is that it's just easier to play around mid. It's the middle of the map, so anyone who wants to help him can get to him faster. Once you're ahead, as any champion, you typically want to look for fights because you should win them and then snowball your leads. At 12 minutes into the game, we see the game basically end. Since he's been able to get lane priority, TF Blade can move to look for fights and make plays elsewhere. With the control ward he placed earlier before getting dove, he and his teammates spot Rek'Sai. They head top for a 3v2 fight and pick up two kills, leaving TF Blade 6-1 at the 12-minute mark. The enemy team gets desperate after this, looking to shut down TF Blade but are unable to do so. Credit is due to his teammates for being there to make sure the fights are even, but having these incredible leads is what allows TF Blade to win basically every fight, and most games as a result. By understanding his matchup and using calculated aggression, TF Blade was able to take fights, build leads, and win games using those leads. Now we're going to jump into another one of his games where he plays Jarvan versus Jace. While this lane is in favor of Jarvan later in the game, Jace is stronger in the early game and is looking to gain a lead through farming gold or even getting some kills by poking or all-inning Jarvan. From there, Jace's plan is to snowball his lead via a split push. Jarvan's goal is to survive the lane phase and look to outscale Jace. From there, he can look to contest Jace's split push or force teamfights to counter Jace's split push. As an opener, TF Blade plays the lane pretty safely, going for farm when his shields are up. At 3 minutes, he gets a gank and takes the free flash from Jace. Shortly after, he sees Lee Sin and Rengar looking for Scuttle in the river, but he doesn't try to force anything. He knows that moving isn't the safest play. Jace is stronger in the early game because he has more abilities, so trying to walk down means he'll have to take either some more damage while walking first or fighting someone who is stronger than him. If he walked down, it would likely lead to a disaster. Jace has lane priority, signifying that he can control the wave, and slow pushes the wave into the turret as a result. From there, he can poke every time Jarvan wants to farm, and in order to get as much farm as possible, TF Blade uses all of his potions to mitigate Jace's poke. TF Blade is in a bad spot here. He is already out of potions and has to let Jace dictate the wave. Since he's in a matchup where he loses early, it's expected that he won't be able to get good trades or solo kill his opponent. What he does do, however, is demonstrate superior wave management to create pressure. Most top laners know that Jarvan will need to recall here. He's out of potions, and if he chooses to stay in lane, Jace will be able to poke him under turret and either force Jarvan to miss CS or dive him if he's low. Jace has decided to push in the wave, and TF Blade farms with his abilities. In what might seem like a mistake, TF Blade moves up and lets Jace jump onto him. While he does take a lot of free damage, he needed to recall here anyway, and he chose a really good time to do so. If you look, you can actually see that his next minion wave is close by, meaning that it'll take time for Jace to finish pushing the wave into the turret. TF Blade then recalls immediately, TPs back to his minions, and then forces Jace to use his abilities to finish pushing the wave. Right after this, he pulls the minion wave while simultaneously looking for Jace in case he looks for a greedy recall. By doing this, he's created a win-win situation for himself. The wave is in a spot that would be dangerous for Jace to be in, and is big enough that if it crashes with his own wave, would make Jace miss farm and XP. With his jungler nearby, he has forced Jace into a risky situation without flash, allowing him to zone Jace from the wave. When Jace comes back to lane, he farms with his abilities because he's afraid of jungle pressure. Eventually though, with Jarvan ultimate, they're able to get the kill on Jace and push the wave in. Jumping forward to 11 minutes, TF Blade TP's bottom lane when he sees the enemy overextended. The results are good. They trade kills, but force Rumble to roam bottom and get the enemy red buff since they forced Kai'Sa to base. Afterwards, he calls for a lane swap. He does this because he knows he won't die, he can pick up some farm, and his bot lane can get a lead in a 2v1 situation. At 13 minutes, he stops Sivir's recall, which is huge. While it doesn't help him get a lead, he is wasting Sivir's time, putting his Kai'Sa further and further ahead, and forces her to TP top lane to catch that wave. Throughout the game, we see him farming and clearing waves, otherwise just waiting for opportunities to make plays rather than forcing them. He plays it slow, not forcing plays, and groups up with his team at 22 minutes. And at 24 minutes, he TPs to make a pick because he recognizes that the enemy team is likely to reset, and there's a safe opportunity to look. Off of the pick he makes here, he leads his team to prioritize Baron Vision and secure it shortly after. This game didn't have the typical TF Blade 1v9 that all of his viewers and fans know him for, but that's exactly why we wanted to show it. In this game, he didn't dominate his lane. He only got one kill and even built a Knight's Vow. Even though the gameplay is different, he again demonstrates that he understands his matchups and practices calculated aggression, only going for plays when it's safe or smart to do so. There are games where you need to carry and games where you need to understand how you have a more supportive role on your team. The ability to recognize both of these situations and then play accordingly is one of the biggest reasons why TF Blade has been able to hit rank 1 on both NA and EU West. Thank you guys so much for watching. Don't forget to click like, subscribe, and leave any comments down below. If you want to see more content like this and improve fast, then please check out ProGuides.com using the description link below. As always, good luck on your next few games, and we'll see you on the Rift.